realize that I spent chapter one, 2 years. I'm not just exaggerating, but I know what I do. But I just feel that if I can communicate what I have about the beginning, and then somehow I can, if nothing else, release what I believe the Lord has shown me here, then the rest is up to the Holy Spirit. And He is all of our sufficiency at a certain time. And there's no truth, no His truth. None of this originated with me, or by the founder of it, or at best, I am just a messenger boy of it. And I don't take that lightly. I'm very proud to be a messenger boy of Jesus. And with the communication, not just the declaration, but the communication of truth that I have been sharing, and now we'll just lay the manifestation of it on you. Nobody can do that. I mean, I'm totally convinced. You know, Jesus spoke, and He said He didn't have ears to hear, let Him hear. It's almost like He didn't say, well, you guys didn't have ears. You know, kind of deal. You know, I don't know who you are. You know what I mean? It was Jesus said, He would have ears. Let it hear. And every one of us wants to have the ears. And for that to take place, we must depend on the Holy Spirit. And you must depend on the Holy Spirit in relationship to the Word of God. And while it is true that you may never handle the Word of God in me, just as I may never handle the Word of God as well as those that come before me, the Word of God is still a necessity. And, faith comes by hearing by the Word. So, here's where we look. The person that we look is the Holy Spirit. The ultimate end of this, I believe to be world evangelization. As far as the temporal ministry, the old I'm talking about, I'm dead here. I haven't go to the ultimate end. The ultimate end of it, world evangelization, as far as the temporal time and then cut off, everything is over with. But everything is over with, that's not the end of what God has done. That's just the end of temporal ministry in this realm. We're going. But even that ministry, I believe, there's something that must precede the ministry of world evangelization. And I believe that to be very simply the body of Christ. Not yet necessarily the new man, but the body of Christ. The body of Christ is that which will eventually be in all forms and shapes the new man the scriptures talk about. But we are only that legally right now, not experientially. Legally meaning settled in heaven, or settled by our acceptance of the cross. But experientially it's not. As of now, it's just the body of Christ, it's not the man. But I believe that God, I believe this very strongly, and I was talking to somebody the other day, and I said, you know, there's a guy that I just went and talked to recently who, for years, we worked together, ministered together. I was the one who led him to the Lord. And he just does not, he's been very intimately involved with me in ministry and whatever. And he just left doesn't believe in the body of Christ as far as necessity in any practical way. He just doesn't believe it. Whereas I have personally shared one end of the scriptures to the other at the time he believed it, but I don't believe it now. And mainly there's real reason why he doesn't, and that is it doesn't suit him. I'm just being honest, it doesn't suit him. So don't take any somewhere along the line, there has to be a higher standard. Somewhere along the line, if there is a higher standard, if you sin and you admit that you sin because there is something higher than you, you know what I mean? You don't restructure the truth to be pleasing to you. And that means if it goes against your flesh, which it does, the truth goes against the flesh. And that's tough to the flesh. That's what we have to learn first. It does absolutely no good to tell that to anybody else. You know, we're first the objects of that truth. And those that the truth has, if you will, had its way. The truth has had its way with us. So what I want to share in John is ultimately I know if some of you have been in the medical class, and they've been talking about different truths, and I was a medic when I was in the Army, and to become a medic, you have to take anatomy and physiology, and many of the things that you're studying right now, so I kind of understand those things. And I understand that a cell is a microcosm of what the whole is. It has all the DNA of the whole in it. But it cannot be the whole. It is only meant to be a part of the whole. This is the way God made the body. You know, that you have all that is of God, and all that is in you, but you are not meant to just be a lone cell. You are meant to be part of something greater. And the greater isn't the body of Christ. The greater is Christ who has a body. And there is a difference of image. The greater is not the body of Christ, but the greater is the vehicle that we have become the vehicle that Christ may live his life. Again, in the earth, but now through this body. And that's the difference. The difference of emphasis. However, for those that would be that body, their emphasis will always be on him and for him. And this will be the thing that keeps you going, that motivates you, that stirs you when you're down, and encourages you. And it's the thing that will be the thing that causes you to encourage others, because it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And it's going to be fully what God has said it will be. The question is, will we be part? Will we tune into that which the Word says? And, you know, you also, you did realize that the Word says something different to a lot of different groups. And ultimately, we must be assured that we have not found the Word that suits our imagination or that suits the doctrines that we enjoy. But that we have found the truth from this book that we know speaks from the Father's heart and bears witness constantly and all the way through and all the blessings. Because that's the only time, you know, and after you see it, you continue to grow, but you're just laying more groundwork for that which you already know. You're just extending the boundaries of what you already know. And just reaffirming yourself over and over in the church. The Word of God continually is that to you.
You mean finding the truth as it is in the whole attributes to you, or foundation, or church, or whatever, the truth as God sees as a whole together.
The main emphasis I would like to say, and yeah, that's true, but to say that, you know, so I'm going to say the truth as it is in the heart of the Father. That's all I'm going to say. That would mean 32 different things. But it only means one thing to the Father. It only means one thing. It don't mean 32 things. It means one thing. My goal, your goal, should be to find out what that's all concerned. Should be all concerned. Not side issue, side track. Oh, I'll check those things out if I can. But so my emphasis is going to be on that there is ultimately there will be one body, and we all recognize that there is one body, but you know, one body spread all over the earth. But you know, what about our brothers and sisters that have gone before, and those that are not yet, if the Lord delays coming, are they not part of that one body? So one body can I even be seen at 1 point in temporal time. You can't put it like that. Therefore, I believe that God has set up what we call the local church or the local body. The local body is to be the local expression of all that Christ ever wanted to be, though it can never fulfill all that, you understand? Because that's, we're talking brothers that have gone before, brothers and sisters that come after, brothers and sisters in the brother. We can never fulfill that in any sort of a, you know, huge, full-belling way. But we can be a microcosm of that. We can be a picture of that. We can be an earnest of that. And that's what I believe. I believe the body of Christ is meant to be not all of it in itself and therefore totally independent of everything, but in itself to manifest the varied aspects of what the whole should be, such as a cell having all the DNA that is of the total in it in itself, but yet not itself truly be. But you can find all of the resources right there. So that's why my emphasis from this up to this point, up to today, I take it from the beginning, from that which didn't have a body, because this was before there was a creation, and therefore before there was a material realm, and therefore before flesh or body was even necessary. But the plan of God, as I understand it, necessitates ultimately a body. So that this great beginning, that not this great start, this that which is from the beginning might have a manifestation through us. So you know, there's a great joy in being a vessel and a channel of that, but to be conformed to that, you know, to let Jesus shoot through you is one thing. For you to be conformed to the image of Christ, that be your nature and all the other things. So I'm going to read some of my notes, because this will help get down the road a little bit with it. Beginning with, because, and here's the point, and let's get a little prelim here. We have discussed in detail the beginning, John 1:1, and all that. We're taking it down to where we're at. And so we've laid all the groundwork, and that is from where the truth comes. Okay? We are going to end up coming down to the gathering together, which will be the body of Christ. And from here, this thing will spread. So, you know, there's a lot of people running out there doing that thing and wondering why, you know, missionaries who are sending individuals and da-da-da-da. And I believe that the reason why it's not any more effective than what it is that God always intended that it be always from a body. In other words, you must be sent from a body, and that you will never just be sent alone. That there is a plan of development. I believe I got that right here from the scripture in John 1. This was the basis that God began to show me and say, this is how to proceed, because I had no clue, and I didn't even, you know, I wasn't even like a young big shot who thought I had a plan. I was running and hiding and afraid because I didn't think I was sufficient. This was one of the most important areas that the Lord began to show me, because he said, this is how you take it from ethereal, where most people can't see it, put wheels on it, drive. This is how you do it. That was big stuff to me, because for a long time it was just spiritual truth of how do you get this thing right. Jesus not only spoke to the local body church in so-and-so, and it's a local body, to the church in so-and-so, to the church, he never said, to Bill over at the, you know, I'm going to church. He said, to the church here, to the church here. And that, I felt that was important from the Holy Spirit, because it's in that line as he speaks to these churches that he says, need to have an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. And so to me, God's building blocks for the new man is local churches. I believe that. I believe it because I think I've seen it in the Word over and over and over and over. So Jesus not only spoke to the local body in the book of Revelation, but when he walked the earth, he formed what could be called a local body. When the time came for Jesus to begin his earthly ministry, when the time came for him to begin earthly ministry, he would not carry out that ministry in the next 3.5 years as an individual. That was interesting. But the Son of God is sufficient. If anybody was sufficient, he's sufficient. But if you will, Mr. Sufficient didn't choose to go alone. He immediately began to gather people for himself. And not just people to preach and then go home. And then come back a week later. Go home. And in fact, you will find that Jesus became home base. Jesus became home base. And this is hard for some people. Like, you know, this is, you know, well, okay, you're forming a cult, you're doing this or that. God knows all I'm trying to do is follow what I ask. What I believe I've seen clearly over and over in so many different ways from the Scripture. And not just follow what's in the Scripture, but the Spirit that has shown me these things, who says, notice this thing, notice this, notice that. Well, this is not a coincidence, right? I go, wow. Certainly it was at the cross where the body originated, meaning in an official manner. There the body of Christ originated. And at Pentecost, it was established in the earth. But in keeping with the truth of the body, and so as not to break spiritual pattern, Jesus chose 12 disciples who would be with him throughout his ministry, and who would take an active part in that ministry. Matthew 10 describes this. He calls them, and he says, you are the ones I have chosen to be with me. So, on one hand, the disciples were the ministry of Jesus, more so than alone. But on another hand, Jesus ministered through them. Go into whatever town I will go. Wherever I would go, you go. Jesus would have contradicted everything he came to establish had he ministered alone. I believe that. I believe that he could not start his ministry and continue that ministry as an individual, because it would have been a contradiction of every book that would have been written after that, that alludes to the body coming together at one. And that all, and the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things. And just before that verse, it says, that we might know the mystery, which is the body of Christ. You know, this was something that was hid. It wasn't made plain that the church, the body of Christ, was coming. All Israel knew was that we're a nation, and that we're the chosen people. And even that was according to the pattern. But the pattern is never the fullness of what Jesus has. The pattern or the shadow is never the fullness of the truth. You know, was Paul Jewish? Yeah. others that they might be saved. The Spirit of Christ working. Okay, so we want to start with the beginning, and we have already shared much on this, so there's no need to really go too much into it. In the first chapter of John's Gospel, we see that certain things had to take place before the 12 could come together and be representative of what God had in mind. Now, this is important because there are a lot of people who are forming new churches, gathering people together. It's a very simple thing, actually. And you put an ad in the paper, find a place to meet. And you say, you come up with a snappy little thing. And, you know what I mean? I mean, anybody can do it. It's really not that bad. However, how many of those come and then go? And come and go. And you see it all the time. And if you think, they were all God raised up, and according to matter and everything, then why do they come and go? And my contention is that the only thing that can truly be blessed of God is that which is according to matter. You say, well, how does something like the Catholic Church or whatever, how's that gone on when it's, first of all, in some cases, they might have some satanic help to keep going. But in another case, the Catholic Church, and where they go, the reason why they spread, conquered the world, was that where they went, they set up a total of crap. I mean, they knew what they were doing. And somewhere along there, they probably saw some truth. And, it's not my desire to tear them down, so I just will say, because, we know, there are things wrong. But I believe there was an element of truth when they first started it. Many churches do start with an element. And then they get off. And the quickest way to mess up with God is to start with His truth and then grow out of that truth. I will not name the name of the church, but one of the biggest churches that had ever come into this area. A huge church. Big church. And I was actually kind of visiting that church and going there and enjoying the presence of the Lord. Because it was truly a phenomenon. It was truly a move of God. And while visiting there many times before new creation started, God showed me that one of the reasons why this church was raised up was because of world mission. Because they were going to financially send money all over the place. And they did. And they did it faithfully. And they did it at times when they were ready to get a new building. I mean, they had almost $1 million, and some missionary came in and shared, and the pastor's heart broke, and he came home and prayed to him and said, God, we'll just keep meeting here in this rented place, And it was truly, it's just the Lord over and over and over and over and over. And then the Lord started new creation, so I wasn't able to go, but at one juncture I was able to go back and visit many years later. When I did, it just happened to be on one of the nights where they had made a decision. This had been like 5 or 6 years later, where they had made a decision that they were sending out too much money. Because, here's how that decision came. They had built a big old huge sanctuary that was like millions of dollars. I mean, way extended. Way extended. Way extended. And so, the conclusion was, we're really sending out way too much out here. I mean, we need to take care of our own first. And, then after we did, what I'm saying? When I heard that, I said, this is the beginning and the end of this church. Certain words. Not even talking about facts at all anymore. And divided up everything else. There is a God-given vision, and there is God-given vision and pattern. Pattern. God will never go against His pattern, and that pattern is filled with, I can't think of the right word, the spirit of the vision that He's given. That pattern is blessed, although you have to be open for it, but I'm just saying, there are basic spiritual patterns that if you're following those in the Spirit, God will continue to bless regardless of this and that. So that's why I said that there are certain things that have to happen before the 12 came together. I'm going to show you that pattern because we think, you know, and I've seen good-intentioned people come together. You know, I've seen people who have been really burned by the religious system come together. And I've seen people that are, you know, just were looking for something different come together. And I've seen people excited over the latest wave of the Holy Spirit. And, you know, there's movements of the Holy Spirit at different times. And that's good, but how long will that last? That church will last about as long as that wave lasts. If they remain emphasizing that way, because just like any way, and then another way to come in. So the idea would be, the best idea would be to plug into that which is eternal and flow with the waves as they come to, but never put those waves as that which is preeminent. Okay, so let me read it again. The first chapter of John's Gospel, we see that certain things had to take place before the 12 could come together and be representative of the local body. The formation of any body must begin the same way. And I believe, personally, that this is God's ideal plan. We read in John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word there is not just in the beginning was the Bible, but the Word, the Logos, the complete thought and concept of God. The Father having a plan that surrounds and is totally involved with this one that later is to be called Jesus Christ, later is to be called the Savior, but at this point has one name in the heart of the Father, the Logos, my complete thought and concept. We all enter in through the door, which is rightfully so. We enter in through the door, which is salvation. But he's not originally called the door of salvation. He's originally the Logos, the complete thought and concept. We must proceed through the door, past the altar, past the laver, into the holy place, past all the different things, through the veil, and see what no man could see for years and years and years until, through the cross, he had done away with the old and established the new. Then you're coming into a new and living way. And this isn't just Christ that's helping you to get in there. You see Christ. And this is the plan of God. That the life of the knowledge of the glory of God the Father, the word glory representing the eternal plan of God, the life of the knowledge of the glorious eternal plan of God is in the face of Jesus Christ. You can't see what is all. It's like going to the Father and saying, you know, show me all this, when in reality, he will show you through Christ, in Christ, of Christ. When you see Jesus, you have seen the Logos. You have seen that this, and this was always the references, this is my beloved Son. This is the one that it's all about. You have been delivered from the powers of darkness and translated into the kingdom of my dear Son, or as the original Greek is, the Son of my love. These are not references to some glorious king who came down here and kicked butt or something. This is the total involvement of the way the Father views the Son, and the light of the knowledge of the glorious plan of God can only be seen in the face of Jesus, because it is. There's no other way. So in the beginning was, and there can be no other beginning. Well, we got together and we, you know, even if you got together and then you saw the beginning, it wasn't the beginning when you got together. It was the beginning when you saw the beginning. As far as the Father is concerned. Because everything's all, it starts, it's all going to be folded up down here in that glorious plan. And that, we can't be assured. That's what happened. The Word of God must have preeminence. The Logos of God must have preeminence. Not the abilities, the personalities of men. So now you drop back to the concept of the local body. and all the abilities, all the, you know, you compare, look around, go visit churches, go see what is the dynamo that pumps that. What is it? You know, in some cases, the charisma of a man, in some cases, the tremendous administrative abilities of man, in some cases, you know, the persuasive preaching of man, in some cases, I mean, there are many, many things that actually hold it together and that make it go. And if you've ever been, many of you here have been in churches for a long time, you have seen that when that man falls, that word falls because that name was it all. Let me tell you, if something has its beginning with that ability of that man or that whatever, it's different. I mean, eventually it's different. It is different. It can't go any further than what that man can. But when you have, like the disciples who didn't see the beginning at first, they walked with the man. They saw his charisma. They saw his miracles. They saw this. And when he was dead, they went, oh, you know, let's go back to fishing, man. Let's make some bucks there and take care of ourselves. And Jesus had to appear and say, get up there in that room and wait for the Holy Spirit. He's going to show you some stuff. And Peter stood up on the day of Pentecost and opened the Word, began to preach what he'd seen. And it wasn't just the Holy Ghost. It was the Holy Ghost came, and guess what he showed us? He began to preach the cross, and the next sermon he preached was even more of the Word of God, but not just the scripture. I mean, not it was the scriptures, but it was the Word of God, the Logos, as he began to say, hey man, you thought David's not among us anymore. He saw corruption. The scriptures, you've always referred off the good old David and this and that. It's talking about Jesus. He didn't see, he rose. And he begins to explain the cross. So these men begin to understand, and that's why John says, like over in 1 John, that this is the very first words out of the mouth of John wrote that 1 John way back. I mean, he was the elder statesman. All the other disciples had died by this time, okay? They were all dead. The 12 were dead by the time he wrote that. He was the only one. He was old. Most of them died young, you know? Died for the sake of Jesus, and he is old, and he was the elder statesman. And as he speaks, he says, and the first words from his mouth, that which was from the beginning, between the Father and the Son, that which was from the beginning, we saw. We didn't see this, that, you know, and at first they didn't. That's why they got afraid. But this guy's going, hey, we got it. Eventually we got it. Eventually we figured it out. We saw it. We saw the beginning. And that's why the true church was not formed until Pentecost. When the Holy Spirit came and began to reveal, then you could begin the true church. But Jesus had to gather the 12 in accordance to the pattern. But the true church didn't really start until he rose, because it couldn't. There's no way, because the true church is the body of Christ. And just gathering people together is a body gathering, but it's not the body of Christ. Amen? Understand the difference? Big difference between just gathering people together, calling it a body of people, and being literally the body of Christ. It wasn't until the resurrection, he came up out of that grave, that we were bone to his bone, flesh to his flesh. And then you can begin to learn what the truth was. They began to learn. Then John said, that which was from the beginning we have seen, we have handled, of the Word of life, of the Word of life. He began to put that emphasis there. And he says, and I write these things to you that you might have fellowship with us who the body of Christ, the new man, the ones who are from the beginning. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and his Son, the Lord. We have fellowship in that. We have intermittent with that. We are one with that because we're in Christ. The Father now receives us, sees us completely, accepts us, totally not based on us, not even considering us. He didn't consider the very beginning before there was an us, and he won't in the end. And so everything that you think is so important that he must consider through the cross, through the shed blood, through the fulfilling all types of the sacrifices. He took care of all of that. Through the ashes of the red heifer, through all the things, you know, that was in case you ever sinned and never knew about it. You know, through every aspect, he covered, so that you could come into one thing. He's all that's what we do. I took care of that. Now, find out what you got. But instead, we live under the Old Testament. I got around Jesus tonight in front of me. Oh God, thank you for receiving me. I know, you know, I'm probably going to mess up again when you, we have an Old Testament relationship. We have no idea that we are in the Logos. If you understood who the Logos was to begin, that's it. You are set. Because he put you, his whole plan was to put you in his son. So that you would, my beloved son, delivered. Delivered. Oh, if God could just chase off them little stinky little hairy demons, that'd be a lot better. Delivered. Translated. Into the kingdom of his dear. You just did total acceptance. You don't even see it. Just melt into Christ, one, not nirvana, but Christ is all in all. The Word of God must have preeminence, not the abilities and personalities of man. A body is a living organism. Okay. Now we have people, we discussed this in many other classes, but we have people that gather together with a body. You know? But a body is a living organism. A body is a living, there's tissue, there's joining. There is sharing of blood. The body of Christ, we share it. And it cleanses and it does all that it's supposed to do. And we are alive. And the ability to stay alive is not, does not just rest with one little cell. It rests with the whole going forward and continually replenishing that. You know, that's why, you know, have you ever bumped into somebody that witnesses door to door and somebody says, oh yeah, man, I'm a Christian. You know, well, where do you go to church? You go, oh, I don't even go to no church. I can read my Bible all on my own. You know what I mean? You just try this. I want everyone of you to try this. Try talking yourselves into individually saying they're going to go eat their own breakfast, lunch, and dinner apart from you. See if they can do that. See if they can survive. There has to be an intake of the body. And through the intake of the body, each is fed. Or are you saying I can't search the scriptures on my own? No, I'm not saying you can't search the scriptures on your own, but I will tell you this. If you get out of the body for a while, you're not fed, you may not see the results. Actually, you probably won't, but we will. Do you know what I'm saying? You ever had anybody that came for a while and then they hadn't been coming for a while and you talk to them and, you know, they're just, but they think they're fine. You're going, you look like you're starving to death. I've even come up to people that said, I'm starving to death. Oh, I don't believe in that. Yeah. And, you know, I mean, maybe one of the reasons why I'm able to share the word and see the word better than you is that maybe I truly am a shepherd. That is called to lead you in the pastures. Where you're not something special that makes Randy special, it makes Randy servant to you. You're faithful to feed the sheep. Hold the word of God and teach the word of God. There's nothing to do with being special, but in fact it's the opposite of special. It's the good old servant of God. But if people, you know, it's like in my house we gather together during meal times, especially dinner time. We always come together. It's old-fashioned people.
50% of most people. To us, it's important that we have fellowship and have face-to-face. You know, there are truths and there are patterns. That's why, you know, I put in our thing, you know, around here. And I mentioned to the families over the obviously it was one of the advantages of the COVID environment is that you don't all just continue to eat all off on your own. Contrary pattern. I mean, sometimes come together. But we have at least one time a month that we call it Fellowship Sunday. A lot of people skip out. Because they go, well, we don't think that. Oh, we don't understand. You don't understand. We don't understand the spiritual principle. You know, you don't understand. And, you know, if you understood, you would work towards the truth. If you don't understand, you work towards independent living. Self-centered lifestyle. It's just the wrong. Condemn or criticize, I expect. I expect that which is truly growing to find itself gravitating more towards the Father, more towards the light, more towards. And I find that which is not growing, I expect it. It's more to gravitate away from certain things and even to hate those things. Well, why? To gather together on Fellowship Sunday, well, that's always when, you know, the best football games are or something like that or whatever, you know, or to eat with other people, you know, I mean, and we think in terms of independence. But I say, whether people get the benefit or not, I say, let's have Fellowship Sunday at least once a month. I say, let's have communion at least once a month. Communion is meant to be a similar thing. In fact, in the Old Testament or the way it used to be done, it wasn't just a communion, it was a meal together. It was called love feast. They were called love feasts. And there's spiritual principle behind all of this, the spiritual principle. But you see people take communion and they kind of go, oh, okay, we did this. This is, and read the scriptures, what is 1 Corinthians 10 and 11, in light of what I'm talking about. And Paul is railing, he's upset, he doesn't do that very often, but he is jumping their face because they come, they bring their own little meal, go off and eat off in the corner together, and he says, you're breaking the whole spirit of what the body of Christ is all about. He says, the very bread that we make is not one body, that we're all one. And he jumps on it. He says, by you eating your meal by yourself, eating before everybody else and doing all this stuff, you're showing that you don't have a clue what this is all about. Right? This is where we get the best teaching on communion. But we don't usually read those parts, but we read the part. It sounds more like a ritual. But he does. I mean, he gets down, too. I mean, he's clear. If you really look at it, he's clear. He's going, man, you know, one eats by himself, and somebody says, oh, I'll eat home, and then come, and all this. And he says, you don't even know what you're doing. You know? Well, we'd say, well, it's just a shadow of the truth. No, that's where I differ. It is a manifestation of the truth. I call that different. A shadow is one thing, a manifestation is another. The true brings about the manifestation. You understand? The true will, and this is where we're heading with all this, the true will eventually break out in the visual realm. And that's what I love about the truth. It will eventually break out. And that's where you get from here, way back before the creation beginning of verse 3, you get this beginning, and then you end up coming forward to verse 14, where it says, in the beginning was the Word, the Logos. Then you end up with verse 14, the Logos was made flesh and dwelt among us. Boom, it broke out. But isn't it funny? I mean, when it broke out, it reforms the pattern in the earth. We're going to see that's what this is. We're going to see that have reformed again because it is like something that is continually developing and growing on a larger scale, but the seed is still the beginning. It's still this oneness between the Father and the Son that cannot be broken, of which we have been privileged. Inner engine. You may have fellowship with us in truth. Isn't those words truth? Our fellowship is with the Father and not a churchy group or a prayer group or a Bible class, a local expression of life. That becomes the determination. When you seek the life, well, what are we going to do about this? And I've seen that happen before by sharing the word with people. And they begin to catch it. They go, well, what are we going to do about this? You know, this is where you get, you know, the dolphins and mountains and stuff. You know, it's like, well, we can't. You know, we've got to, well, you know, man, it's like, you know, and then it just overcomes you. You just got to act on it. You know, the truth will captivate you. Thank God for that. The truth does captivate you. And it's greater than you. But you got to be exposed to it for a period of time. Amen? You know what I mean? I mean, there needs to be, because it doesn't automatically just say, I am Jack. You know what I mean? I mean, it affects you deeply, but the more you're around it, the more the truth draws you and you go, man, and eventually it captivates you, and eventually you are a servant of Jesus Christ. Call to be an apostle, or call to preach, or call to take care of Sunday school, or call to run a mission, or call to help out with the, you know what I mean? I mean, but let me tell you, none of those positions or ministry titles that we talked about make any difference at all. Every one of them are an expression of this original thing that has gotten hold of you, and I must serve the Lord. I must be about my Father's business. How about that one? And that will, the beauty of it is that because you are an individual expression or channel of expression, He will express Himself uniquely through you. And that is so cool because He's unique and you are unique and nobody else can demonstrate Christ quite the way that you can.
That's right.
Isn't that wonderful? Nobody! I mean, even if you've got two ears or two eyes, one eye is stronger than the other or one, you know what I mean? Nobody, you know, has the four keepers and this and that. Well, that is just a general truth that nobody can you. Only you are you, and you are a particular member. Now, when we say that, we go, oh, glory to God, I'm a particular member. No, not like you join the club. That's not what we're talking about. You are, a better way to say that is that you are a particular channel for expressing Christ. Nobody else can express Christ before. And God knew you, and knew you personally, and is not ashamed of you. Not ashamed of you. Not ashamed to call you His brethren. Not ashamed of you at all. But desires you because Him with you is what the plan of God was all about. Christ in you, the hope of glory. So quit crying about this and that, and you ain't like so-and-so, and he deals with all this. Well, you say, well, because I'm not the eye, I'm not of the body. Yes, you are. Hush up. You weren't supposed to be the eye. You are a particular expression that's not expressing itself because you're too busy trying to be an eye when you're not an eye. You know? Yeah, but the eye is important. No. You know? Nothing else here, I'm sure. Thank God we just got eyes. You know what I mean? And that's that, I mean, we all laugh because that's foolish. But it's foolish to you, it's foolish what you think. Shall we say it like that? It's foolish. You are, I mean, I can say this without hesitation, you are beautiful to the Lord. You! No, I don't just mean Christ, I mean you are beautiful to the Lord. Not because He's got them ugly eyes and thinks you're beautiful when you're really ugly and sin. No. Because all you see is your stinking sin and all your ugliness and stuff. But He sees who you really are. Because half of the time, most of the times that you're getting off on into who you really are anyway. You're trying to peer pressure, trying to live up to somebody's standard, you're trying to be something, you're trying to, that isn't what you are anyway. You'd be a whole lot happier just being you. Really, I'm serious. You mean it's just a much happier way to just be you, be content with who you are. But don't leave it at just I'm content with who I am. Because you know who you are? You are a unique expression of Christ. Now, be content with that. Now, if you're going to just go drop Jesus off in this field and say, well, I'm a very special person. Well, no, I special cup, and you are very special to the Father as you take your place in this plan. But I mean, if you're not going to, you know, if you're, let me tell you, if you don't go with Christ and become that expression, then automatically there's not a lot of options left. There is division, there is cancer, there is, you know what I mean? A cancer cell is different than a healthy cell. It's drawing from the body, relating to the body, feeding off the blood. You know what I mean? It's different. It's dying. And it's killing everything around it. Okay, so. But what makes it not cancer is life. It's full of life. And the life of my cells is me. And the life of Jesus' body is him. And he is already there. He is already there. So it becomes a quest to begin. Because this new man is going to be made up of individuals who have come together. So it's not still just a self-centered individualistic search. Paul says it like this. When you gather together, this is him. This is the way he views it. This isn't just me, but I've had people go, oh, man. You just, you know, they say that the body of Christ is a metaphor in the scripture. That it's just a metaphor to teach. No, it's not. He didn't take you out of Adam and place you in a metaphor. You know, you are in the body of Christ. You are the body of Christ. He said, brethren, you are the body of Christ and members in particular. He didn't say you are metaphorically speaking. You are the body of Christ. And Paul said this. He said, you cannot say to another, nor can you complain about yourself not being this or that. He said, every member is important. And that God adds to the body such as pleases him. So if you don't like being added to this body, cut cookies. God added you. You know, and I know a lot of people who are not real happy about that. And, you know, on one hand, I'm not either. I mean, on one hand, but when I really look at the whole thing, God put me here and God uniquely put you here, you know, this is where I'm supposed to be. This is where I belong, saying the Lord. You know, he put me. And so this is where I will be. This is where I will function. I was talking to Mary about this. She said, you know, the heart of the original DNA is in every cell. And she said, but those cells end up forming things such as a heart and lungs and the liver. And I said, yeah. I said, each one of them have the original. Every one of them has the original, though every one of them doesn't have the same function. Because some come together and form the function called the heart. Some come and they function differently. But do not and never think that what you are is function. What you do is function. What you are is bone is bone, flesh is flesh. What you are is one in Christ. What you are is accepted in the blood. What you are is if you are one with him, that he that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. If you ever feel like your spirit isn't right or you're messed up or whatever, you need to remember what you are and come to agreement with the Word of God. Because if we come out of agreement with the Word of God. Okay? So I said, so we're not speaking of forming a prayer group or Bible class, but rather a local expression of life. An expression of life. An expression. All we're trying to do is form an expression of life. Now, I mean, we can't form a life. That's pretty presumptuous. But we can form the expression. We can be the channels of that expression. But the only way to do that, folks, is we've got to be in touch with the head of the body. We've got to, as we are, every member holding the head. He says in one place, here's the reason why you have the problem. You're not holding the head. From which every Georgia Notre Dame, that's what he said, from whom, actually, from whom? Every Georgia Notre Dame finished, Okay, so I said, not provided by the local expression of life, verse 4 says, in him who is the Logos, was life. And the life was the light of man. To see this is to have light. To not see this is to walk in darkness, or since we're not there. Well, let's just see what the text is.